Ciao, ciao a tutti.
Ciao Ian, buonasera, bentornato a questo secondo webinar sul Barbaresco, quest'anno dedicata all'annata 2017, un'altra grande annata molto differente dal 18, quindi molto interessante se l'avete se li seguite tutti e due questi webinar. Passo la parola a Gabriele.
Aspetta che faccio la traduzione. So welcome everybody to this webinar, second in a series. We did the last one just last week for those of you who followed us. Last week was devoted, of course, to Barbaresco and its terroirs and the wines of the 2016 vintage. This time around, we're going to focus always on Barbaresco and its terroirs, but especially on the 2017 vintage. Prego.
Allora, passiamo la parola prima di Ian a Gabriele Occhetti, il rappresentante dell'Enoteca questa sera, ex presidente, vicepresidente. Prego.
Okay, so thank you Marisa, thank you Ian. So just few words for introducing to everyone a little bit, not for sure, Ian don't need a presentation, but just for explaining what we are doing tonight and what we already done last week. So basically, Enoteca Regionale, it's an important, it's a kind of house for the Barbaresco. That's a kind of organization born more or less 35 years ago with the idea to be a collector for every producer of Barbaresco, to have more focus on the market and especially on the export market. So today Enoteca is based in a nice shop in an old church. And thanks to the group working there, a lot of connection worldwide, really with the goal to talk about Barbaresco everywhere and every time possible. 2 years ago, we started to have an important event. The name is Espressioni Barbaresco, with the focus to guest year by year an important opinion leader in terms of wine and to have a discussion with him around a kind of a table round about around the Barbaresco. So the event of this year, that's where we are guesting Ian, is just online for sure. It's still very, very difficult to make a meeting all together in presence. But thanks to Ian, we want to have a focus on the last two editions of Barbaresco, in fact. Last time we talked about 18, the one released this year, but we don't want to forget 17, because 17 has been released in 2020, a very, very difficult year. So most of Barbaresco were already sold, even in a pandemic context. But by the way, we need that people as Ian can help us to have more focus on this vintage, because Barbaresco always needs good opinion and good talking about it. So thank you again, Ian. And I think that we can start our meeting.
Okay, thank you very much, Gabriele. So as I had occasion to say last week, I'm very happy to be here and talking about Barbaresco. Really one of the world's most important, most famous red wines, one of my favorites, and it's not just because I have all these producers here around me, but I think those who know me also know that it's true. I like Barbaresco. Besides, I have to say, I love doing these webinars because I live in Shanghai now and it's 2 a.m. here and I get to drink. I get to drink, so every excuse is good. So I've got these 8 phenomenal wines, and so life is good. Anyways, so, you know, Barbaresco, I think everybody who's listening to us knows everything there is to know about Barbaresco, but I just want to point out a few very quick things. And then, of course, just a few words on the 2017 vintage. And then we'll talk about these 8 wines with these 8 leading estates of the area. So you all know that Barbaresco is a 100% Nebbiolo wine, and the DOC was created back in 66, DOCG back in 80, and it's a wine that really embodies what the Nebbiolo grape can do, like basically no other. It is a different wine from Barolo. People often tend to think of Barbaresco as maybe Barolo's little brother, and that's really unfair because the two wines are equally great and very different. Barbaresco is born in an area where the hills are gently sloping and slightly lower in altitude. Most of the vineyards are from 150 to 300 meters above sea level, but there are areas where they reach 500 meters above sea level. Barbaresco in general, the denomination is closer to the Tanaro River, and that also contributes to have a more temperate mesoclimate. Last but not least, the soils of the Barbaresco area are for the most part soils that were formed during the Tortonian stage of the Miocene epoch. And that means that these soils are mainly blue-gray marls with lots of manganese and magnesium that give you faster maturing earlier to approach Nebbiolo wines. It's a very relative term with Nebbiolo to talk about early maturing, because a good Barbaresco from a good vintage will last 40, 50, 60 years without a problem. If you're lucky enough to find a very good Barbaresco from the 1947 vintage, it's still a very beautiful wine, but just not 1947, 1961 or 67 or 71 or 78 or 82, 85, 88, 89, 90, 96. All those are great, great, great wines, and they're still drinking beautifully today. There are four communes to the Barbaresco area: Barbaresco proper, Neve, Treso, and San Rocco Senodelvio. And San Rocco Senodelvio is often called Alba because it is in fact a hamlet. It is in the periphery on the outskirts of the city of Alba, which is perfectly fine. Alba is a world famous city, much like Beaune is in Burgundy. So there's nothing wrong with that. But I always tell people they really should refer to it as San Rocco Senodelvio, if for no other reason, because Elvio is the name of a Roman emperor, Elvio Publio Pertinace, who was born in this little town. Alberto Cisasinari probably can tell us a little bit more about that too. But the fact is, this little town, basically this area, gave birth to a Roman emperor. And so it makes sense to even broadcast that. So the Barbarescos of these four communes are different. And much like the wines of Margaux and Pauillac give equally good but different Bordeaux, and much like the wines of Chambolle-Musigny and Gevrey-Chambertin or Volnay and Pommard give equally good but different Burgundies, it's the same thing with the communes of Barbaresco. And that is very important because in different vintages, the wines will be different. 2017 is a vintage that was somewhat hammered in the press as a hot year and the year in which the wines were not maybe as great as 2016 or other vintages. In general, what happens when you have a great vintage like 2016, the vintage that comes right before it or right after always gets sort of forgotten and kicked by the wayside. And 2019 is another vintage that everybody talks about with glee. And so vintages like 17 and 18 somewhat get forgotten by the wayside. And that's a shame because it's hard to generalize in wine. And even in a so-called difficult year, there are some very wonderful wines made. So why is 2017 saddled with the reputation of being difficult? Well, it was a year that has some frost episodes, that had some hail episodes, and it had some episodes of drought. Around Easter weekend that year, hail hit, and especially the area of the township of Neve got hammered, and some vineyards, some famous vineyards, like for example, Bah, Fauzoni and Currah really, really had some problems. But that's a limited area, and the hail clearly doesn't hit everywhere in the same amount. There were some late frost episodes when, again, in April, the temperatures dropped and the valley vineyards were hit, but the slope vineyards were spared. And the other thing about the 2017 vintage, people often talk about a drought, but in fact, there was quite a bit of rain in August, and that saved the vintage, and that gave the chance for the vines to recuperate. And when people talk about heat and drought, they forget that in September, many areas in the Barbaresco area were actually characterized by very cool nighttime temperatures. So there were good diurnal shifts, and that allowed Nebbiolo to give the perfumed wines that we expect from the grape. And in fact, when you do drink many 2017 Barbarescos, they're excellent wines. And I've got some here that are really, really, really fantastic. Last but not least, because the townships are different, townships and the wines will behave differently every vintage. So for example, in a year like 2017, in vineyards that are higher up, such as those of Trezzo or those closer to the river, are going to benefit from different climatic conditions. So it's never a good idea to generalize about wine and growing seasons. There are characters to each vintage. And even though within a character of a year, there's always wines that are surprisingly good, as is the case with the 2017 Barbarescos. And the last thing I always point out is, although we tend to think of Barolo and Barbaresco as being similar, in fact, they aren't, and the vintages are also very different. So 2011 and 2014, there are another two vintages that have a so-so reputation. In fact, were pretty good vintages for Barbaresco, probably better than Barolo. And I think it's the same thing with Barbaresco, with 2017, which is a good Barbaresco vintage. And again, I've got some real beauties here with me. So we're going to talk about this a little bit. And we're going to start with Prunotto. Prunotto, c'è Emanuele? C'è Emanuele.
Ciao, Ian.
Hey, ciao, non t'ho visto, scusa. So Emanuele Baldi, the dynamic duo, Emanuele Baldi, Gianluca Torrengo of Prunotto. Prunotto, really a world famous house. they've really been around forever, and very important house for many, many reasons. Back in 1961, this was the house that really launched cru labeling for the first time, the Barolo Bussia and the Pian Romualdo vineyard for Barbera. It's an estate that really has done remarkably important things. It started as a social co-op way back at the beginning of the 1900s in 1904, Ai Vini delle Langhe, which was the original name. And when they notarized the deed, a witness there was Alfredo Prunotto, who then in 1922, when the social co-op closed, took over running the estate, named it after himself, and was there until 1956 when he sold. And then the estate, which was being distributed in 1989 by the Antenori family, one of Italy's most famous families, then passed when the Colla brothers retired. They took over as of 1994, if I'm not wrong. So Prunotto, one of the very famous members of the Antenori family of estates, a quality leader in the area, and very happy to have Emanuele with us here. Ciao, Emanuele.
Ciao, Ian, and hello to everybody. It's a great pleasure to be here. I apologize from the beginning. I will have to leave, and I will not stay with you all the evening. But it's a great pleasure to talk about Barbaresco. And Ian, you said most of what I wanted to say, so I'll be very fast. That's the label of the Barbaresco Classico. And as you said, Prunotto was the first in 1961 to select single vineyards. And I will leave Pietro Colla, which I can see in the screen, talking about his grandfather, Pepe Colla, who was a visionaire in understanding the importance of the terroir in Piemonte after in Burgundy. But the Barbaresco that we are tasting tonight is actually the Barbaresco Classico. So Barbaresco Classico was made since 1905. So Barolo and Barbaresco were made since the very beginning of the history of the Barolo. And while of course I understood you had a seminar talking about all those different vineyards, it's key to understanding the quality and the diversity of Barbaresco. It's also very important to remember the idea behind the Barolo and the Barbaresco Classico. And the idea behind the Barbaresco Classico is to blend different single vineyards, different cru, in order to create a very balanced, approachable Barbaresco that can then age for a very long time. So Barbaresco Classico from Pronotto is made from different single vineyards, part from Barbaresco and part from Treiso. We are talking about Montaribaldi, which is where we also grow Brituroth, Secondine, just below the village of Barbaresco, Cars, which is just in front of Secondine, and then two vineyards from Treiso, which are the Marcarini and the Bricco di Treiso. So the idea is to really, I always say, like in a quartet of instruments, like in a, you have a cello, a violin, a viola, and a double bass. If they play on their own, sometimes those instruments can lack balance. But if they play together, then you create a beautiful harmony. And that's the idea of the Barbaresco Classico from Pronotto. You said everything about the 2017 vintage. I believe for the reason you just said, low yield, warm and dry summer, but cool temperature. So great swing in temperature during the harvest. It's a very approachable vintage, beautifully concentrated, that deliver a lot of fun straight away. So you don't have to wait to enjoy the 2017 Barbaresco yet, because of the concentration, has quite a long life ahead. So it's a Barbaresco that is beautifully drinking right now, but it will deliver some great wine in the next 10, 15 and more years. Mm-hmm. So the idea is the Barbaresco Classico. So it's to represent the style of Pronotto, the style of Barbaresco, elegance, finesse. As you said, Barbaresco is not nothing short of Barolo in terms of quality. I always say Barolo and Barbaresco are the two sides of the same coins. So they express the magic of Lange, they express the magic of the Nebbiolo from this special terroir, finesse and elegance, of course, being the characteristic of the Barbarescos. Any questions?
Yeah, so Emanuele, so for example, just to understand, now, first of all, again, I think most of the people who are listening to us probably know this, but historically in Barbaresco, as in Barolo, the wines are always blends. They're always people blending grapes from different sites to get the best of each site, because in the vintage, one area would get hailed upon or rained upon, another would not. And so the idea was to blend the best grapes from different areas, also to create a house style, a blend, whereby you'd use grapes from a more powerful area. About 20% of the Barbaresco area is characterized by soils that were developed in the Serravalian age, so compacted sands and limestone, which give later maturing Barolos as opposed Barbarescos, as opposed to the ones that come from wholly Tortonian age soils that are characterized by the St. Agathe's marls, as opposed to Lecchio formation soils. But the point is, that historically Barbaresco was always made as a blend of grapes. And so the Barbaresco Classico, I think it's always a good point to tell people, to remind them not to talk about a base Barbaresco or an entry-level Barbaresco, because Barbaresco is always a great wine. It's never an entry-level wine. It's never a base wine. Then there are the crus, and those are expressions, or the MGAs as we call them now. Those are expressions of specific sites. And they're beautiful wines, they're fantastic wines. But Barbaresco historically is a blend. The one question I have for you, and honestly, I don't know, so I'm asking, since you farm vineyards in two different communes and they're different vineyards, in a year that might be slightly warmer, do you, for your Barbaresco Classico, do you tend to use more grapes from Treiso? Like, for example, you farm Bricco di Treiso, which is a very high located MGA. So it would make sense to me in a year like 2017 that was warmer on average, you might want to use more of those grapes, but maybe you can't, because maybe you just don't have enough. So is that something you do, or you don't do that?
Let's say the blend is very similar every year. But of course, as you say, the higher elevation vineyard in a warm vintage like 17 give you that edge, that that backbone, that tension, that the warmer exposition will not give you. So definitely, you always try to find the balance. But I would say that generally speaking, what we produce in terms of what we, in this case, most of the vineyards for the Barbaresco Classico are grapes we buy from suppliers, and we use most of them. So it might be that 1 year or another, we will discard some of the vineyard, but most of the time we will use, if not all, but part of the wine from every vineyard.
Okay, gotcha. Well, thank you very much, Emanuele. Thank you for being with us. I know you have to run. Congratulations for the wine. It's a beautiful wine. It's a powerful wine, but it's characterized by very fine tannins, beautiful nose of slightly riper than usual red cherries, but still that sour red cherry note, roses, and a little bit of camphor. It's just a very nice wine. The main thing, very beautiful tannins. So wonderful wine. Bravo.
Thank you very much. We'll pass
my pleasure. Congratulations
to Gianluca, who makes the wine.
Oh yeah, of course. Say hi to Gianluca for me. Gianluca Torrengo, for those of you who are following us, a very nice man. And I've known Gianluca and Emanuele for over 20 years now. And I've been lucky to know.
A long time ago.
Ti ricordi? Mythical vertical. I still remember that vertical. Okay, bello. Grazie. Yeah,
ciao, thank you very much. Ciao, and Emanuele. Forza Barbaresco.
Forza Barbaresco, vediamoci in estate. Io spero di venire, se non per giugno, luglio, spero di essere di nuovo da voi, dai.
Assolutamente, okay. Ti aspettiamo. Salute,
cheers. Grazie, saluti a tutti. Ciao, ciao. All right, good. So that was great. Now we're going to run off and go to Belcolle. Belcolle is an estate. That ci abbiamo qualcuno di Belcolle con noi?
Non lo so.
No.
Okay, c'è problema. So we don't have anybody from Belcolle with us. Belcolle is an estate that was founded in 1976 by Franco and Carlo Pontiglione and Giuseppe Priola, and then the estate was sold just a few years ago to the Bosio family of Santo Stefano Belbo. It's an estate that is famous also because it makes a wine from a rare grape variety called Pelaverga Piccolo or Pelaverga Comune, and it's a wine that they've been acquainted with. But of course, this estate makes exceptionally good Barbarescos, and they're lucky to farm two of the very best vineyard sites of all Barbaresco, in the Paiore and the Roncaglie. And we have the Podere Colla estate with us, that will tell us probably quite a bit about Roncaglie. This is the Paiore. This is the Paiore of Belcolle. That is the label. You see it there. And Paiore is really a fantastic vineyard. It was made famous by Giovannino Moresco, and it's a vineyard of Treso. It's a little lower lying part of Treso. Roughly 150 to 300 meters above sea level. So it's not an example of a steely Barbaresco from the Treso commune as maybe one from the Rizzi crew that we'll talk about later, or maybe Bricco di Treso or Bernardot. But they are somewhat fleshier wines, more similar to those of Barbaresco, and the Paiore crew has the ability to give exceptionally nuanced, exceptionally powerful, really exceptional Barbarescos. Again, I think Barbaresco is wonderful as a blend of grapes coming from different sites, but there are some MGAs, some crews that give remarkably great wines. Of course, we know the Produttori di Barbaresco makes a series of fantastic Reserva wines from single crews, and each is very different, each is very beautiful. And this is true of the Paiore vineyard in Treso, which really is, I think, one of the 10 or 12 greatest vineyards really that we have in the whole denomination. Very famous and rightfully so. The wine is a little bit on the riper side than usual. It has a note of dark plum and ripe red cherry. A certain savoriness to it, a note of camphor, even a hint of tobacco, which is not all that common in Barbaresco wines, and a very beautiful underlying harmonious acidity and a tannic spine that carries that fruit, that softer than usual fruit on a long suave finish. Belcolle, not the most powerful wines in Barbaresco, but very well balanced and very easy to drink. 17 especially is more approachable. And it's a wine that I really, really recommend you try, because maybe it's in a state that is not as famous or as well known as some other ones in Barbaresco, but I think that the wines are very approachable, very easy to like, and frankly, very, very enjoyable. I had a great time with this one, and I always enjoy drinking the wines of Belcolle. So well done. And it's not easy in 2017 to get tannins that are as smooth as these are. So very good for them. Besides Belcolle, we'll give more time to the people who are with us and who can talk about their estate. One of the most famous and well-known estates of the Barbaresco area is Cisa Zinari Marchesi di Grazi, or Marchesi di Grazi for short. And of course, we have Alberto with us here. This is an estate that really has been associated with wine for the longest time. Already in 1797, the family had had an estate, and for the longest time they were selling grapes. And if I'm not wrong, Alberto, correct me if I'm wrong, but you're the one who really wanted to make wine. And I think back in 1973, you decided to do so. Prego.
It was a shame to sell like this vineyard to the others, but we have a lot of people presenting tonight. These are present tonight, like the buyers were, you know, exactly the same thing here.
Bravo.
Mine is closed. Maybe you have open. So no, I think that, you know, Martinenga is one of the more iconic vineyards, which is practically is the south exposure part of the valley or the hill, which on top is there is on the left side, Asili, and on the central right side, watching that from, for example, the street that is going, the road is going Neve to Alba, passing across the hill, and the locality called Tre Stelle. We have a great point of view from there of Martinenga, which is included. It's like the reunion of these two other crews, which are Asili and Rabaya, because it's the major part of the vineyard, of the hill, surrounding the exposure to south, practically. So it's what my tractors enter in the left and the exit on the right side, making Martinenga apart. Then there's the Gayun, which is being start to be selected since 82. Then there all the amphitheaters again Martinenga, and the right, very right part is not until the lower part, but the top on the right side is called Camp Gros, which is starting to be selected since 1978. So it was a great passion for me to take care about this property. Nobody else was doing that in the family before. I mean, my father was a lawyer, but he passed away, unfortunately for me, very early. I was only 4 years old when he passed away. So my mother, she was, you know, remaining widow with 4 children to grow. It was not easy. And we are staying in Milan, like, you know, in the past. And I take this passion to go on the fields and on the vineyard, to drive tractor, to drive. That was the initial story. But very quickly, you arrive until today with a lot of different experiences in the every vintage. So that 17 itself, he has like a special condition because of the, or the you know, the season, that season, that confer to the wine a kind of minerality, a little bit more than the normal. So I think it was a sexy wine in the beginning. And in fact, I was proposing this to my friends, my clients, very, it's finished practically. We don't have any other bottle left. So it was a very significant vintage because Martinenga, you see, it's never been, never has a reputation like a powerful Barbaresco, always like an elegant Barbaresco. This elegance is provided from the site itself, from the exposure of the vineyard, altitude or not altitude. The lower part is the house itself, Martinenga, the farm is at 238 meters level. So I suppose that the vineyard can arrive to 320 maximum at a stop, but the major part is around 260, 280 meter. So it, we can consider it's not, Treviso is taller in general. My house in Monterey, Aribaldo, that is providing Dolcetto mostly in some white varieties, also 1 hectare of Nebbiolo. The last year we replant because it was used to be also there. And this is the top of the house is 400 meters and it's right in lane with the Brico di Treviso, like my friend and our friend, unfortunately, he passed Pio away Boffa. This year.
Pio Boffa.
Yeah, Pio yeah. Boffa. So Paiore, for example, is like below that house and the top of the hill. It's not that lower. Paiore is is a medium average, but more height than lower is exposure for vineyards. And so Martinenga has this, the 17 has this good condition of drinkability, which is a little bit more elegant than usual. For example, the 16, very well known, everybody loves, I think is among the 2010, 2020 is the one, 2019 is the best considered, the 16. But mm-hmm. the 17 really, it shows for the moment, maybe because the 16 is still a little bit too much important, and it's gonna be great in the few two to five years mm-hmm. to grow. He has a little bit, he's a little bit closed today. The 17 is more available, it's more direct, it's more pleasant, it's more, you know, he's a Barbaresco. And Barbaresco, mm-hmm. you know very well, you mentioned before, rightly, is not like a Barolo, it's something different. But the very genius thing here in this context is discussing is the Nebbiolo. The Nebbiolo has been to the school because it is able to read every meter square of the land which is planted. So even in Martinenga, which is a united vineyard, so it's not many other pieces that you blend. It could be also interesting, mm-hmm. but mm-hmm. Martinenga is like a monopole because nobody else can call Martinenga, luckily. And so we have seen that in a distance that could be 1 kilometer, 0.200 meters total from the left to the right, he has many different exposures because it's an amphitheater, so it's a little bit southwest is the major part, south-south is only the Gayun, and southeast is the little bit, the very first part close to our friend Giuseppe Cortese, for example, we are bordering with the Camoras, and there is a little bit east also. But you know, everything is on the south, around the south. But believe me, the Nebbiolo is able to see every single aspect of the terroir, more yeah. than any Barbera, more than any Dolcetto. Mm-hmm. Don't speak about Sangiovese, because if you go in Tuscany, which I have a lot of friends, they are making similar Chiantis from the northern part of to the south part, because the Nebbiolo, the Sangiovese, evidently is not been to the school like the Nebbiolo.
I think it's the important thing for people to realize if you haven't been to Barbaresco is that this long slope is really one of the most beautiful parts of viticultural Italy, not just in the Langhe. You have these amazing vineyards, Asili, Martinenga, Rabaia, and it's just one continuous slope that's really remarkable, and it's just really sort of it's just really a remarkably beautiful area where some of the historically most important wines have been made in the area. And I think Martinenga is characterized by giving a very elegant wine that may also have to do with the winemaking. But in fact, I really think, as Alberto was saying, it's the site, because even in 17, you have a remarkably elegant wine, very beautifully acid, but it's a harmonious acidity. And the wine is very light on its feet. So this is an example of when you say, oh, 17 is a ripe year, 17 is a hot year, but you'd never guess it if you drink this wine on its own and blind. And that's the key to what makes a great viticultural site what it is. It's able to give you a fantastic wine independently. A lot of that has to do with vine age. In your case, you also have a little bit of Nebbiolo Rosé in your vineyards, correct? And that way, yeah. The color of your wine, I always tell people, when you look at Martinenga, you're going to see that the wine is actually garnet tinged, orangey at the rim already when young. It is never Martinenga, one of the darker Barbarescos. And that is because I'd say 15 to 20% of the grapes are of Nebbiolo Rosé. O quanto sono ormai, Alberto?
No, ma di rosé ce ne sono abbastanza pochi, perché...
Sono diminuiti negli anni, no?
A few. But anyway, it was a big challenge for me in the past to convince your colleague, giornalisti, delle guide, or the guides, because they were not believing Nebbiolo was... They were getting something atypical. Instead, it's because of the land, the composition of the land, and the clone, of course, not the clone, the protein nest also. Anyway, the variety itself, which is, I think, a little part is the selezione massale.
Yeah.
Once and it was only one clone for the Nebbiolo.
And if I'm right, Montaribaldi, your home there, you own since the 1600s, right? From 1635 or something?
My crew is called Montaribaldo.
Yeah, Montaribaldo, sorry, yeah.
Montaribaldi is another, is a brand.
It's the crew, yeah.
No, Mike, it's the Luceto crew, it's not the Barbaresco crew.
Sì. Però stai in famiglia del 1600 e passa, no?
Sì.
E Martinenga invece l'avete acquistata?
In where now
Martinenga l'avete acquistata nel 1797, giusto?
97 no, non è stata acquistata, è stata regalata.
That's beh, meglio ancora.
It's very lucky for us, you know. We are very lucky. We already consider myself very lucky, man. We really. Also because now that we are a new generation here with me, she wants to be...
That's his daughter.
Shadow. I don't know why. It's
Ciao.
And Alessandro, they have been a lot, so I'm very, very, I'm very lucky. Why not? Lucky.
Congratulations.
So we
have the
property in 1797 from a certain other Marquis that was a companion for hunting with my grandfather. It was another Carlo di Grasi, but not my aunt, my grandfather, which was Carlo, the one that made a house for the family to stay in the summer. They were from Torino, or the generation for the Grasi, apart from myself, which I'm born in Milan, but all the rest of the, for generation, for centuries, they were staying in Torino, coming here just for hunting, for, you know, the sport was not the soccer ball that day, or the basketball, to never be in Italy, was to hunt, to go with the dogs, to see the dogs working, and the hill always are a big challenge when you are hunting, because you have to go up and down. So it's not easy, no? So they were making
some sports. Grazie Alberto, thank you Alberto. So again, if anybody visits the Barbaresco area, I thoroughly recommend getting an appointment and seeing this estate, because it's really located in a really beautiful part of Barbaresco, and the wines
proprio
are...
Bella. It's very nice to be seen, Martinenga, other than good place to grow grapes.
Barbaresco, the whole denomination is really beautiful and different, but I think that whole slope with Azili and Rabaya is remarkably beautiful. So thank you very much. Congratulations for your wine, because
I apologize,
it really...
we have to go for a dinner, one of the first Christmas dinners.
Congratulations. Happy holidays to you and your family.
Thank you so much.
Happy holidays to you and your family.
Ciao.
Thank you.
Ciao. So after one historic estate, but relatively young estate, because Cisa Zinari was really formed in 1973, to another relatively young estate, but where the people have been involved in winemaking forever, Podere Colla. We have Pietro Colla with us. In fact, the Colla estate has been associated with wine forever, already back in Ammazza, quanto era? 1703, Carlo Colla and the San Stefano were selling wine. And this is an estate that has a long lineage of very important people who have really made the history of Barbaresco. And it's very, very important to know about Pudere Colla, that on top of it farms one of the greatest vineyards in the whole area, Roncaglie. Pietro, ciao.
Ciao, Ian. Ciao. Hi, everybody. Hola. Hi, how are you? Thanks for this nice opportunity for me to talk about our family, our history, and our wives. And as you said, my family started making wines and selling grapes, and always involved in the world of grapes and wines since 1703. So it's now more than 300 years. And we have documents that we know that we started in the era of Moscato, so Castiglione Tinella first, and then we moved to the Langa in the era of Alba. Yes, here we are. So the recent history of Pudere Colla starts with Beppe Colla. So Manuele Baldi from Prunotto already said something before. So my uncle was the owner and the winemaker of the winery Prunotto since 56 until 1990, when he sold the winery to the family Antinori. But of course, he only sold the winery, the name, but he kept the vineyard. So he kept Roncaglie. That for him, Roncaglie was one of the best crew within Barbaresco. And we have to say that he started making wines from Roncaglie in 1958, so a long time ago, always buying the grapes under the label Prunotto. And he had the opportunity, we have the opportunity to buy the land, so the property, in 1993. So the first vintages of Roncaglie under the name Colla, Pudere Colla, was 93. And Roncaglie, the name Roncaglie, to be honest, was not very famous in the past because it was never produced as a crew. It was always made to produce the classic Barbaresco. So until 58 to 1992 was made as a classic Barbaresco, so blended also with other vineyards. And we started as Pudere Colla only in 1993. And today, Roncaglie is the only crew of Barbaresco we own. We have to say that Roncaglie is the smallest crew in the Barbaresco area. It is located in the southern part of the village of Barbaresco, and it is only 13 hectares big. And we own about 8 hectares, so 60% of that. Roncaglie is like a big amphitheater that facing west and south, and the altitude, it is actually quite low because it goes from 200 up to 250 meters above sea level. So it is also, it is quite low, and it is very, very hot in summer, but it is an amphitheater which is open to the river Tanaro, to the Tanaro Valley. And it is important to say that in Roncaglie, we have also the river Senodeglio that cross the property. So it is open to two rivers. And this is very, very important. Two rivers gives Roncaglie a little bit of freshness. Otherwise, it was quite hot. And as you said before, today, growers and producers are fighting against this kind of extreme weather condition. Like you said, the frost and the lack of water in summer, the heat in summer, the radiation of the sun, which is always stronger and stronger. So this is our new challenge in the next years. So looking at the map, Roncaglie borders on the left, Roncagliette. And the west part is Roncagliette, and on the east part is Monte Ribaldi. Both Roncaglie and Roncagliette, in the very beginning, They used, it was a unique property owned by the Conti Galleani, a very, very important family from Barbaresco, and they also used to own the castle and the tower of Barbaresco, and little by little they started selling their properties in the past. And the reason why my uncle chose Roncaglia, because as you know, in the past it was possible to buy grapes almost from all over, buy land almost from all over, but he likes Roncaglia for its taste, for his kind of wine, because wines in Roncaglia are very nice, delicate, they are balanced, elegant, but at the same time they are quite strong, and they also have a good potential of aging in the bottle. So this kind of combination, that was something that he was looking for in the wines. And
so basically, this area where Poderricolla makes their Barbaresco is another very beautiful slope that is situated south of the previous slope, the one that we were talking about that has Azili, Martinenga, and Rabaia. This is another slope that starts at the Roccalini crew and moves through Roncagliette, Roncaglie towards Treso. And it's another very beautiful slope that's south of the other one, but also with very, very high quality vineyards. Roncagliette and Roncaglie are quite famous, and as they should be. And I think that the winemaking at Poderricolla is highly traditional. The wine is sturdier already in its youth. It's a little less approachable maybe than some other Barbarescos, but it ages also very, very well. And this is a wine that already in 2017, you can tell, not as approachable as some of the other Barbarescos in this tasting, but one that will age better, I think, than many others. Pietro, è una vostra precisa prerogativa di fare vini in maniera abbastanza tradizionale. It's your house style to make fairly traditional wines, correct?
I am the grandson of Beppe, so I'm not saying I am obliged to do that, but this is what I learned, and also this is what I like. So what we do what you just said. So quite long maceration. We use concrete, and then we put our wines in a large cask. We don't use any new wood or barrique. So big body. They are actually quite big, between 3,000 liters and 9,000 liters. And so there's no new wood and no barrique. And after that, the wine goes straight in the bottle for at least 1 year in the bottle also. And yeah. From Roncaglie, we only produce one wine, so Roncaglie. But in 2015, we're producing our Riserva, which is a special selection from old vines within Roncaglie, which is, this wine is not on the market yet, but I think we are thinking to put this wine on the market maybe in 2-3 years, something like that.
Mm-hmm. Okay, great. Thank you very much. Grazie. Thank you very much, Pietro. So an example of a sturdier, more austere wine when young, and that will develop splendidly even in a vintage like 2017. And again, a very noble wine for those who haven't yet tried it, Roncaglie by Poderricolla. Always continuing then in alphabetical order, we should have Fratelli Giacosa now. Abbiamo qualcuno dei Fratelli Giacosa o parlo io?
Parla pure no? Tu.
Okay, I'm going to talk away. I'm glad to do it. This is the bottle. This is what it looks like. Let me show you. This is the, it's a little hard, is this crest. Barbaresco up top, and Fratelli Giacosa there in at the bottom in the type. Fratelli Giacosa, fratelli in Italian means brothers. And these were, in fact, four brothers who originally were at the at the helm back in the 19th century. You had Leone, Giovan Battista, Costantino, and Giuseppe. These were the four fratelli Giacosa. And Leone, unfortunately, died in a hunting accident. Giovan Battista, GB for short, became the parish priest of a town. Costantino went into the police force and became a carabiniere. Costantino is actually maybe less famous than his son. His son, Dante Giacosa, is a very famous man in Italy because he worked for Fiat and he is the designer who designed the Fiat 500, the 500, the very famous car that everybody knows all over the world and really an iconic Italian invention. And that is the creation of Dante Giacosa, son of Costantino of the Fratelli Giacosa. And it was Giuseppe, the fourth son, who really wanted to make wine. And he had heard that there was a small holding, a small estate, if you will, in the township of Neve that was for sale. And at the time, they wanted all of 3,000 lire for this estate. 3,000 lire, to give you an idea, if we turn that into dollars, lire don't longer exist. We have euros now, but it would have been the equivalent of a dollar and a half, if you can believe it. It's amazing how time changes, how time flies. Anyway, so the Fratelli Giacosa, Giuseppe wanted to buy the estate, he couldn't, but funny story, I mean, I don't know how true, but supposedly that night he went to sleep, he dreamed a bunch of numbers, so the next day he decided to play them in the lottery, and he actually won, and he was able to buy the estate. And that's a pretty crazy story, but it's a very interesting story indeed, and why not? So the estate now makes a classic Barbaresco such as this, and then also makes a Barbaresco from another crew in Neve called Bazerin, which means kissed by the sun. So they offer the two different versions of Barbaresco. They also make Barolos, of course. But the Barbaresco, I think, is a lovely wine. I actually find it fairly easily here in China. And it's one that I love drinking because it's always very fairly priced, and that's always important. And it's always very, very well made. It's a very well-balanced wine. It is never one of the most powerful Barbarescos, even though it comes from Neve, which is known to give wines that are a little bit more powerful, for example, than the very balanced wines of Barbaresco and the slightly earlier maturing wines of San Rocco Senodelvio. But it's always a very easygoing and approachable wine, even though it has a tannic structure that is typical of Neve. It is a remarkably well-balanced and easy to drink Barbaresco. I think it's a great wine by which to get to know the area and its wines. I think that, again, all denominations have very famous wine estates, and some are not as famous, and Barbaresco is no different than many other denominations. There are, in fact, many, many, many wine estates that are members of the Enoteca Regionale and that we could have had the wines of in this masterclass. I mean, I had to pick a bunch, and, you know, we can't really have more than eight wines or we end up staying 4 hours in the Zoom. But really, there are many, many, many estates that are part of the Enoteca Regionale, and I really recommend that you try to go beyond the tried and true, go beyond the wines that maybe you know. If you ever go to Piedmont, by all means, visit the Enoteca Regionale, because it's a great way to get to know many estates that you might not have had a chance to taste back home. I know I've been doing it ever since ever since I was young. I mean, I've been going to the Enoteca for I don't know how many years, and it's a great way to get to know new producers or producers that you just haven't had a chance to taste. Fratelli Giacosa, a lovely estate, and this is a wonderful wine. The 2017 Fratelli Giacosa is really, really a great Barbaresco, and I really recommend you try it. You'll be very pleasantly surprised. Wonderful wine, really. We then have Giuseppe Cortese. Giuseppe Cortese, Gabriele talked to us earlier. He gave us a welcome to this webinar, and so now I'm going to let him talk. He's the largest owner of the Rabaia Vineyard, which is an absolutely mythical vineyard, legendary status, not just in Barbaresco, but I would say in all of Italy. Prego.
Thank you, Ian, again. So now let me talk a little bit about the estate. So in fact, Giuseppe Cortese today is the larger producer inside this famous MGA Rabaia. We talk about a small land. We talk about an area. This is more or less 15 hectares in total, just on the top on the Martinenga that were introduced by Alberto Di Grisi before. And in fact, Rabaia has the reputation to be today one of the most famous. Sincerely speaking, I think that it's a nice mix of some combination, where in the Rabaia you can find together a perfect exposure to the sun, because the vineyard look all in the same way to south-southwest. So in Rabaia, it's almost impossible to be wrong in terms of quality of vineyard there. And at the same time, we talk about an historical vineyard. If today we go and we walk through the Rabaia, we can see as the average in terms of age of the wines, it's really, really nice. I think as today, the average is more or less for something like 45, 50 years old. So, you know, old wines, it means a kind of natural concentration, that it means definitely high quality from the in the bunches. This is, as you know, for making a nice wine, we need a perfect raw material. So that's why we talk about this homogeneity in the quality there. And after, as we told before, one of the first where people starting writing the name of the single vineyard on a label. So in terms of our history, Giuseppe has been one of the first farmers probably in Barbaresco that decide to move to a wine grower, selling grape to become a winemaker. That happens in 1971. So on this year with 21, we are celebrating 50 years of a label. And at the beginning, the starting was not so easy. You have to imagine what it means starting from a old school and more simple vision of a farmer idea to become a winemaker. But step by step, Giuseppe improved the winemaking, improved the property, and step by step, the wine start to be a point of reference in Barbaresco, in the Rabaia for sure. And especially, let me say, really on a kind of a small icon of the traditional style. Before we already talk about the traditional style, almost all of my colleagues talking before are making this kind of interpretation of making wine. So for us, it's very, very important to talk about this style, because for me, personally speaking, I think this is the most important way explain the beautiness and the unicity of Barbaresco when we compare with other important fine wines worldwide, because the Nebbiolo in the traditional style allow us to enjoy the light, brilliant color, the wonderful complexity in terms of flower and red berries, and never too big body to have something that has become difficult to approach, difficult to age. Difficult to approach, even if we survive the idea of wine for long aging. So Barbaresco, it's a fantastic wine for me. Very proud to be there and very proud to represent one of the most historical level and important single vineyard.
Absolutely. No, it's a great, great wine. Really, you can talk about a steel fist and a velvet glove. You have a very powerful wine. Rabaya gives you a powerful wine, but it's a very nuanced wine with delicate small berries, a tar and licorice, and even a sort of hint of chocolate. It's actually a very, very nice wine. But in Cortez's version of Rabaya, often very mineral too. It's a very saline mineral wine. So really sort of a graceful wine, yet very, very powerful. And of course makes a Reserva, which is very famous and very sought after. You know, I always have nice memories of the Rabaya by Giuseppe Cortese, because when I used to live in the States, it was a wine that one could find and was really one of the really best Italian wines available, because back in the late 70s, early 80s, it wasn't always so easy to find great wines in smaller cities. New York, sure, San Francisco, sure, but you know, I lived in places like Cincinnati, and believe me, it wasn't as easy. So great, I really have nothing but wonderful memories of Giuseppe, Federico, really great family. Congratulations, it's a beautiful wine. And again, another example of a wine that really does not at all speak of heat or of drought. It's just great winemaking, a great terroir, older vines, and right away you have a fantastic wine. Molto, molto bravo, buono davvero, sai, veramente buono. Io l'ho assaggiato da te in cantina l'anno scorso, se ti ricordi. I was visiting Cortese last summer and tasted this wine along with a bunch of other wines. And it was great. I mean, it was great already then and just great right now. Molto buono. Bravo, grazie davvero.
Thank you again.
So then now we have the produttori di Barbaresco. Produttori di Barbaresco, you see this is the classic label of the Barbaresco with the tan color. And I'm just going to pour it. I'm just going to pour this one. And it's remarkably famous co-op. I don't need to tell you, everybody knows this co-op. Not just me, but Robert Parker has called it the greatest cooperative in the world. The wines are just of an amazing level of quality, beginning with the classic Barbaresco, of course. Everybody knows about the Cruz, the Reserva wines that were launched in 67, that by the way are still beautiful today if you're lucky to find one. Fantastic. They also make a very famous Rabaya that was probably launched in its fame by a very famous local area restaurateur who bought the whole production or close to it. And anyways, just a great, great co-op, founded in 1958, if I'm not wrong, and Aldo for sure will correct me. The parish priest got, I think, 19 local poor producers to get together. Anyways, nothing but an amazing success story. Produttori di Barbaresco, prego.
Thank you, Jan. You are a Barbaresco encyclopedia.
Salute.
Salute.
Oh, è buonissimo, te lo dico, è buonissimo, buonissimo.
Grazie. Yes, you're correct. The winery was founded in 1958, 19 members by the priest, founded by the priest of the village. Currently, we have 53 farmers, and they farm 120 hectares. The total Barbaresco appellation is 700 hectares of Nebbiolo grapes. So we have a good share, 18%. Of the Barbaresco appellation. The one thing about Produttore that probably everybody knows, but it's interesting, we are a mono varietal winery. We are probably the only winery in the region, in the Lange, that focus on one grape only. It's always been like that. The priest, when he founded the Produttore in 1958, he told to the farmers, we are going to build a winery next to the church, right in the main square. And here we are going to make only Barbaresco. You deliver here only your Nebbiolo grapes, because we have to bring Barbaresco back where it belongs. At the end of the 19th century, Barbaresco was quite famous, side by side with Barolo. But then we had First World War, then we had fascism, Second World War, depression in the middle, while Barolo was a little more geared up to survive this first part of the last century, Barbaresco went into a sort of a sleeping period, with the exception of the Gaia family. Not much was going on in the village. So in the 50s, Barbaresco was basically still a poor village of farmers, but the memory of the golden age of the end of the 19th century was alive, when Domizio Cavazza was living in the castle making wine in the center of the village. So the priest had this idea of bringing back Barbaresco. So that's the reason why Produttori decided to focus on Nebbiolo only and Barbaresco only. We make the single vineyards, as you mentioned, since 1967, and we make the Barbaresco since 1958. This particular wine, another thing that maybe not everybody knows, it's a blend of many different vineyards, some parcels from the single vineyards themselves, plus vineyards from other locations. We have plots in Bazarin, we have plots in Cotta, in San Cristoforo, in Facet. We don't make those as single vineyards, so all the grapes from those vineyards, they go in this blend. And then, of course, we take a little bit of Pora, a little bit of Monte Stefano, a little bit of Ovello, also to make these wines. So this is a rare, very representative wine of what the vintage is, because it comes from many, many different parcels, from many, many different vineyards in the Barbaresco area. 70% of the grapes, more or less, are from the village of Barbaresco. Another 25%+ from the village of Neve, and then we have a little bit of a couple of hectares in Treiso, but we are mainly focused on the village of Barbaresco. 2017, as you mentioned, it's an excellent vintage for us. It's a beautiful minerality, our wine from 1917, while 16 was all flesh and richness and powerful explosive fruit. 17 is a beautiful minerality in the finish that makes it quite attractive, slightly more classic. What saved the 17 vineyard was the small crop to start with. So we're going to make single vineyards in 2017, but there's a smaller quantity than usual. And we had this beautiful September month with very cold nights and very hot days. And that's, of course, we all know that that's perfect for the developing of the aromatics in the Nebbiolo grape. So thanks to this beautiful September weather and a relatively late harvest, 17 vintage is considered excellent in Barbaresco, right in the line with 16, 15, and the vintages before. A good way to start to enjoy the vintages, starting with the classical Barbaresco, the blend. Then, of course, we're going to release the single vineyard 17 next year, because they're sold as reserva, so they will come out next year on the market. Enjoy the wine and the vintage.
No, but you see, Aldo, that's very important. You know, the people know that you will be releasing 2017 crus, because you don't always do that in every vintage, and you only do it in the better vintages. So for a vintage that often people will criticize, often even without drinking the wines, the fact that you will be releasing the reservas from this vintage tells people that in fact it was a very successful vintage for you and for the denomination. In fact, the 16s, as great as they are, and they really are great wines, are very tough and austere right now. They need plenty of time. So where a vintage like 17 really comes in is that it gives you a chance to drink a Barbaresco while your other Barbarescos maybe mature in the cellar. So it's a very good restaurant wine too. This one here, classic Barbaresco, really is drinking very well. It is remarkably mineral and saline, and it is just a beautiful, beautiful expression of Nebbiolo fruit. And it is not at all harsh, and it is not at all gritty. It's just a great, great wine. It just has this fantastic Nebbiolo acidity that really extends the flavors on the finish. And it really makes you salivate. I mean, it just makes you want to eat. And in fact, that's what a great wine should always do. So beautiful wine. I think it's also wine that is relatively easy to find for people living anywhere from Alberta to Washington to Rio de Janeiro to China. I just think it's a wonderful way to learn about Barbaresco and to get to know the nuances that this wine can deliver. So congratulations, great result in 2017, also a very beautiful label, let me tell you. I don't know if you know, Aldo, I don't know if I ever told you, but I gotta tell you, this is a funny story. This is the label. I don't have one of the crews with me, unfortunately. I should have thought of bringing it anyways. This is the classic label, but the crew label, the Reserva labels, I'm sure all of you have seen it. You remember it's white and it's got the little logo of the man.
Yeah, John has one. John is showing you one.
Ah, perfecto, perfecto. Thank you very much, John. Thank you. That's great. So you see everybody, you see that close up, the yellow background and the man wearing red. Well, believe it or not, funny story. Thank you, John. That's a cool story. So I was in Chicago visiting a friend who's a great wine collector and he's a doctor and a lovely man, Brad Fine. I'll just say his name because I love him. He's great. We were together in pediatric residency when I used to be a doctor. And anyways, there was an auction of vintage posters. And I was looking at these posters, blah, blah, blah. And then finally one came out, which, believe it or not, was the original poster of that label. It's a very old poster. It's an authentic poster. And I decided, what the heck, I'm going to buy it. And back then it was affordable. But there was this little old lady who also wanted the poster. And she just didn't give up. And so she kept raising the price. And in the end, I had to pay a ton of money because she just wouldn't give up. Finally, she gave up. Anyways, but I have that poster framed in my apartment. And it's...
fantastic.
No, veramente, sono proprio orgoglioso, sai, è proprio autentico. Now, it's not worth as much as it could be because it was slightly ripped and they had to fix it. They fixed it very well, but it's just a beautiful, beautiful, it's a beautiful label, but I guarantee you it's a beautiful poster too.
Yeah, it was printed in 1910, so it's over 100 years old and it has this beautiful, warm, pastel color, very beautiful, yes. We have a couple of... originals at the winery as well. It was made to promote Barbaresco as an area and as a wine back in the days.
Il mio originalissimo, sono proprio orgoglioso. It's really beautiful. And imagine that when I had it framed, the guy who was framing it, he actually, when I went in to get it and I paid and I brought it back home, he said, you know, I am so glad that you came because I had this thing in the window and it was ruining me because people were coming in every day wanting to buy it. So anyways, bene così. Okay, last but not least, grazie Aldo, very good, congratulations. By all means, everybody, you know that the Produttore di Barbaresco is located in the heart of the Barbaresco town, basically at the other end of the street of where you see the Enoteca Regionale. And it's really a beautiful town to visit and lots of cute little restaurants, by the way, right there. So definitely make a point of going there. Last but not least, we have the Rizzi estate owned by the Della Piane family. We have, ciao. Vedonchi Enrico, Iole, ciao Enrico.
Ciao.
So the Rizzi estate is called the Rizzi, but that's in fact, it's a toponym of an area, a very famous crew in the Trezzo area. The family is instead called Della Piane. We have Enrico Iole with us. Prego.
Grazie. Ciao. Thank you so much. Rizzi is the name, okay, it's a very big name in the big level. Rizzi is the name of the winery, but really is the name of the geographic hills, geographic house. The name Rizzi is no our family. It's just the name of the hill, our house, my grandfather. Rizzi is onomatopeico, I don't know, because it's the name of the hedgehog. It's la collina dei Ricci, the big, the small animals. And the name is Richie Riz, Riz Rizzi. Is it just for this name? Enrico, vuoi parlare?
Okay, so hello, Ian. So enjoy the wine.
Ciao, Enrico.
Ciao, that's
tutto bene, grazie.
It's not easy to ship the wine in China, eh?
No, it's not easy at all. Let me tell you, it's just recently because of COVID, they have found that COVID can also be transmitted by boxes and by packages. So because of that, they've really clamped down on the packages. So it was fine. When I first moved here about a year and a half ago, I had no problems getting packages. But then earlier this year, they discovered, because China's closed, right? They don't allow too many people in. So they were getting, and they do real quarantines here. I mean, you really get stuck in a hotel for 2 to 3 weeks. And I know, believe me. And so, but they were wondering where the COVID came from. And then they found that it was being transmitted by boxes and by packages. So when they found that, then they started really clamping down even on that. So right now it's a little hard. Hopefully it'll become better soon enough.
I hope. Yeah. No, fortunately, the importer shipped to you the wine. So,
it's great. I'm very happy to have it. Lovely wine. Beautiful.
Okay. So, that's for me, it's interesting. That's today to explain about the Rizzi, because we have a different crew in Treviso. So, our Rizzi estate is a focus in Treviso winery. And we have a different crew, Rizzi, Nervo, and Pagliore. And today I'm very happy to show the Rizzi because the name of the crew is also the name of the estate. I don't know, the Pagliore is a much more known crew, but Rizzi is not so known also because we own the mostly part of the, more or less 50-60% of the crew is our estate of us. And naturally, we have a so big Rizzi name, so we didn't use so much in the past Rizzi, because many times people ask me, your is a classical Barbaresco. No, Rizzi is a crew. Sometimes it's difficult to understand that Rizzi is the state, but the Rizzi at the same time is also the crew. But for me, it's important, and then it's my flag wine, because Barbaresco Rizzi is a wine that we have more production, and naturally is also the wine that I'm very proud of. It's a particular crew. You know absolutely the characteristic of the geology of Treviso and Barbaresco, but the Rizzi is quite a little bit unique crew, because inside the same crew we have the top part where we have the vineyard Boito, but also other vineyard that is more like characteristic of the soil, more similar to Barbaresco soil, so the Marle, the Sant'Agata, Sabbiose. And the other part of the Rizzi, the lower part, is a Serravallian soil, so formazione di Lecchio, older soil, more sandy. So it's quite particular when I promote the Barbaresco Rizzi. It's like to have a sort of a blend of two different kind of soil. So in the same crew, we have two different soil, and so it's take the characteristic from one part, the characteristic of similar to Pagliore and Barbaresco. Another part of Rizzi is more similar to my crew in Nervo, that is classical of crew of Treviso, so more mineral, more vertical. And then the Pagliore is the more powerful and rich, and the Rizzi is more or less in the middle. So I have the characteristic of the two crew, so the two different soil and geological soil. So this is, for me, is important when I explain the Rizzi. And in general, it's always the wine is quite approachable since the beginning. And also in particular in the vintage 17, that's is a very good vintage.
Good balance.
Yeah, and then we made the different, I taste many 17 in general, and the average quality is quite high for all the producer. Mm-hmm. The producer, and at the same time, I find that even if all people expect in the 17 warm, hot, the wine, I find a good acidity. In particular, in Treviso, I find always wine with a good acidity in the 17, but also in other village. Probably Just the other producer friend say about the characteristic of the weather in September, October, that was not so hot, but there was a good excursion of warm and cold night. So this permit to maintain the some freshness and acidity. That's I think that's 17 is well represented this characteristic.
Yeah, no, it's a very mineral wine. It's a very austere wine in its youth. It's a little readier to drink in 17 than usual, but it's certainly a wine that is less approachable than some other Barbarescos when they're young, so it needs a little bit of time. In 17, because it's a little warmer, it's already readier to drink now. The Rizzi is also a very steep cru, so it's really a remarkable sight. It's very easy to recognize when you're there. It's really impressive. The gradient, and it's an example of the Serravalian soils and how they give you a more austere but very elegant, very refined wine that has a very beautiful verticality to it, even in a year like 2017. How many bottles do you make of the Rizzi, by the way?
In the 17 was more or less 20,000 bottles of Rizzi.
Okay.
Then there was a little bit less than you, but in general it's around this volume. And then fortunately I'm very happy because the sales was good, even if the 17 is a vintage of COVID, because going to the market in the 2000, but probably during the quarantine period people drink quite a lot, so fortunately was okay. So I'm quite happy to sell, and then I suppose also my colleague can say the same about the in this moment of the market for Piemonte, for Barbaresco. I think that is a good moment. So we have to wait what's happening in the future, but there is a good interesting in this wine. And then also it's important that we are here all together and we speak about Barbaresco. We are very proud of our wine. I think that's we are arriving at a good maturity of the knowledge of our potential and the knowledge of the and our powerful of Barbaresco producer. So
well, thank you very much, Enrico and Iole. The wines are excellent again, and I think the producers that we have selected for this this Zoom webinar are really emblematic of what good producers, hardworking, passionate producers can do in a year where, you know, some other producers had a harder time because of the vintage conditions. But I think these wines have a beautiful minerality to them and a beautiful freshness and enough fruit that they can really support the tannic underlying power of the wines. And like I say, in some cases, the wines are remarkably approachable and ready to drink sooner, while the 2016s, even the 2018s, mature a little bit. So congratulations to the producers that have been with us, because they can be very happy with what they've done in 2017. It's a vintage that, at least for a good chunk of the Barbaresco denomination, really doesn't deserve the reputation of being hot and droughty, because the wines don't necessarily taste like that. And that's important to say. You know, a lot of these wines have 14.5% alcohol, but you don't really feel that alcohol because the wines are balanced, in fact. So a very pleasant surprise. And I say the same thing when I talk about the Barbarescos from 2014, a vintage that many people think the producers shouldn't even have bottled because it rained, because it was cold. But in fact, Barbaresco 2014 is a very good vintage, and the wines are in fact drinking beautifully right now. So congratulations to everybody. I'm just going to say a few things on also the local foodstuffs of Barbaresco. While we talk about, we can talk also about food and wine pairing, but the Barbaresco area isn't famous.
Sorry,
just for...
Young. Prego. E Federico Ceretto che vorrebbe alzato la mano, vorrebbe parlare.
Non lo vedo, Federico, dov'è? Ok, Federico, Ehi, hey, ciao, eccoti, mica ti ho visto. Bravo, bravo. So Federico Ceretto of the Ceretto House, very famous estate, makes very well known for their Barolos, but in fact make fantastic Barbarescos from the Azili vineyard and from the Bernadotte, Azili in Barbaresco, Bernadotte in Trezzo. I always tell people that it's easy to talk about Azili because it's so famous. But in fact, Bernadotte is just a fantastic vineyard. And I love high altitude vineyard, very elegant, very vertical wines. Ciao Federico.
Ciao Ian, ciao ragazze, all'Enoteca, grazie dell'invito. I'm so sorry I arrived 45 minutes late, but between all these Zoom addresses, I get connected to a seminar last week. So, so I found out with messages that someone sent me the right link. So I don't know who I have to thank, but someone sent me the right link a few minutes ago. So nothing, Enrico and Yole, they already said about Trezzo. We share the same proud for this beautiful village. And you're right, Ian, the interesting part of Bernadotte is the elevation. Well, the exposure, it's almost perfect. Bernadotte is a vineyard that has, it's like a big triangle. So the top of the hill, the top of the vineyard has a very perfect exposure and also very windy, warm and windy exposure. And the elevation, it's between 420 and 450 meters. So we are really high. The highest appellation allowed, if I'm correct, is 500 meters. So we are almost at the very top. But the soil in Bernadotte are very similar to Serra Lunga, so marl and very rich. So you have this bite in Bernadotte, this texture that is balanced with the freshness yes, Enrico was talking about vertical expression of the wine. Yes, in Trezzo you can find this very straight on wines. And so it's interesting to taste, to go through the different layers in Bernadotte, because you go through the freshness and the fruit and then the richness. We started in 1997, the 97-98 vintage. We tried aging with a very, very large cask, like we used to do for the Classico Barbaresco. Then we moved into more barrique style for the aging, and now we came back since 2015 vintage to the larger cask. So we went through circles, and we are now focusing on pure fruit driven fruit. I have to say this when you talk about Nebbiolo, fruit for us doesn't mean the sweetness or the juicy part of the wine. When we talk about fruit, we talk about the Nebbiolo varietal expression, because the floral notes I don't know, I think it was Cortese talking about the floral notes and the red berries. This is really what that intrigues you when you scroll the wine with the Nebbiolo. And then, you know, it's a lighter color wine. It's a very floral nose and red berry nose. And then the acidity and the tannin, they grip your palate. So it's a wine with delicacy and personality, Barbaresco. And it's really appealing and powerful at the same time. And of course, like all the great Nebbiolo wines, has a fantastic aging potential. Even if I have to say that the big question, in my personal opinion, the big question today is about the how much compromise we probably have to face, because the climate change is a reality and the harvest condition for us are changed. You know, when you talk about Piemonte and we still hear the stories of our grandfathers. You listen of stories of epic harvest in a very foggy, humid, cold condition. Today, all of us, we harvest in t-shirts, and beautiful sunny days. This is why you see a lot of vintages released in the last two decades. Before, the great vintages were 2, 3, the good vintages were 4, 5, and then we went through 2, 3, 4 bad vintages, or bad, tough vintages, really complicated vintages. This brought the maturation of the wine on the vines with a lot of phenolic, a lot of tanning extraction potential, so a lot of aging potential. Today, the wines are more elegant, more pure, more fruit-driven, more terroir expression for sure, also because we learned, you know, we have 20 generations of vigneron know-how and 3, 4, 5 generations of great winemaking knowledge. So now the wines produced here are fantastic. They are very great expression. But the tannins of the 60s, of the 70s, it's old history. Today we have very nice tannins, much riper fruits, much easier harvest. The wines are more pure and more, the wines are fantastic today to drink. We are not, it's not only more approachable because we have a nicer touch. The touch is the same, no? Is that probably the climate has changed a little bit, and we, at the moment, we take advantage of it. In the long, long run, we will be able to drink 17 in 40 years. I don't know. But at the same time, we have 16, we have 13, we have 18 that will age a long time. So we can play a lot. In fact, today, Piemonte is the funniest, most amazing wine lover kindergarten, because today you can jump in Lange, or in Piemonte, Alto Piemonte, Piemonte, Monferrato, that you can buy wines for 20 euros or 1,000 euros and have unbelievable fun with the expression, with the diversity, with the joy of drinking a great bottle of wine. At the moment, we are really the most interesting wine region to visit if you like to open bottles, no? And because, you know, today we talk about, you know, I'm super happy of Latache. I dream to be the owner of Latache, or just the winemaker of Latache. You know, I don't know how many bottles you open of Latache. You can open 750 times more bottle of Barbaresco and have the same pleasure. Of course, your neighborhood will not be jealous about the bottle you're drinking, but you will be the happiest person in the world. So it depends what you like to do. If you like to have a good life or make your neighborhood jealous, that is all about. We make wine for people that like to open bottles.
Yeah, no, and it's true. And what we were saying is, you know, Barbaresco truly deserves the reputation for being one of the world's greatest red wines. What Federico was saying is very true. If you think back in the 1960s, really the only three vintages that were good or great were 61, 64, and 67. All the other ones were either downright poor or barely average. In the 1970s, you had two really great vintages, 71 and 78. And then the other ones, 74, 79, maybe slightly above average, but 77, horrible, 72, very bad.
My vintage probably was not even allowed to bottle it, or part of the
appellation. Yeah, no, 72, there were basically no wines made bearing that name. So, and you know, it's different now, beginning with the 1980s, as Federico was saying. It's easier to come up with Barbarescos year in and year out. Last but not least, also based on what Federico was saying, the Bernadotte Vineyard. The Bernadotte Vineyard deserves a word or two more, because as Federico was saying, it's characterized by being located very high up. We're talking almost at 500 meters above sea level. And so that is really a very good example of the high part of Trezzo, the most steely Barbarescos of all. They're very unique because there really isn't an Nebbiolo wine made like those of the high part of Trezzo, not in Barolo, and not in Barbaresco. So it's really a unique part of the Barbaresco denomination. Like we talked about Paiore, a fantastic vineyard, but a fleshier wine that resembles more some of the great wines of Barbaresco proper. When you get into Bernadotte, Brico di Trezzo, that is a totally different area, very high up. The wines are very steely. If they were Mosel Rieslings, you would say Saar, as opposed to wines from the Pfalz. And so Bernadotte is a very unique vineyard. It's a vineyard that I think has really amazing capacity to deliver great wines. I remember a 1978 Bernadotte wine I drank. It's not important to say the producer now, but
I think it was Carello.
Truly an amazing wine. So I was very young and I've always loved Bernadotte. And I think it's an estate that it's a crew, it's an MGA that deserves to be better known. And like, if you like steely wines, it's really steely and very beautiful, very refined. So thank you, Federico. So the wines are great and the foods are great too. Of course, you all know in Barbaresco and the Langhe, you have the white truffle and that's famous. We talked last week about honey. A lot of people don't know that Piedmont has the largest number of beehives in Italy. But in fact, there's other products that are very interesting. One of the products that is interesting is the corn cake, the galletta di mais. And the galletta di mais has been made in Piedmont forever for the simple reason there's a lot of maize grown in the area. In fact, people don't know that Piedmont has some native varieties of corn, of maize. Corn arrived in Italy thanks to the discovery of the Americas. Christopher Columbus discovered Central America in 1492, and in 1493, corn arrived to Europe. It had not, it was not known here before. It arrived in France and Spain. And the first place where corn grew in Italy was in Veneto in 1554. In 1580, it was planted in Friuli. In the 1630s in northern Italy around the town of Bergamo, and in the 1700s it arrived in Piedmont. But what is interesting about Piedmont is, much like there are native grapes, there are also native varieties of corn. So for example, the Pignoletto variety exists in two colors, red and yellow, and in fact the Pignoletto Rosso is also called Pignoletto Rosso. It's one of the oldest varieties of corn there is, and it's highly, highly typical of Piedmont. The Rivetto estate is located in Serralunga, but it makes Barbaresco as well. It makes about 90,000 bottles a year. It's run by Enrico Rivetto in a very eco-friendly, eco-sustainable, biodynamic way. And they make about 6,000 bottles of Barbaresco a year. And they also make this product, these galette di mais, these corn cakes. And why is that important? It's important because it's a very healthy product. About one galette only has about 30 calories, no fat. It's a very healthy food. But it is made with local varieties. And the Rivetto estate uses varieties of corn like the Rostrato, like the Spinato, the Pignoletto, and the Ottofile. The Ottofile is a variety of corn, a native corn that also is available in a few different color codes. So there's the Ottofile Bianco, white Ottofile that is probably best for bread. The Ottofile Giallo or yellow Ottofile corn is also known as Ottofile di Lamorra. And the Ottofile Rosso is known as Ottofile Albese. So you're talking really about Langhe and Barbaresco areas. These corns are all very high quality varieties of corn that were somewhat abandoned in the 1950s, because that's when the hybrids from North America were brought over. The hybrids are very good corn species. It's just that they produce a lot more, and that's why they took over from the native varieties. But just as Italy has over 500 different native grapes, different wine grapes. It has over 400 different olives. So there's not just one olive oil in Italy, but there's many different olive oils based on the region where the olives grow, but also on the type of olive. And it's the same thing with the corn. So Rivetto makes these galette di mais that are made with different corns. And, you know, you talk, for example, of the, I don't know, the Rostrato variety of corn. Well, but you got to realize there are many, many different types of Rostrato. There's the Rostrato Rosso di Rovetta, the Rostrato Rosso di Pianura, there's a Rostrato Nero, the Rostrato Nero di Esine. And so these corns are a feature of the biodiversity of the land, and it's very important that we're bringing them back to life. And it's really enjoyable to see that these corn cakes are being made by using rare varieties of corn that are especially rich in vitamins and minerals, and a very healthy, nutritious snack. Very easy to make, water, salt. You cook the corn at about 250 degrees for about, really all it takes is 5 seconds. You put it through a very pressure, high pressure machine, and the starch acts as a glue and glues the cornmeal together. And that's how you make these corn cakes. Also very important in the Langhe, in fact, probably even more important is hazelnuts. I gotta show you, there they are. These are hazelnuts. The hazelnut of Piedmont is the best hazelnut in the world. And I know it sounds funny to say that because you think, oh, well, of course he has to say that because it's Piedmont. But in fact, it's, I don't know if you can see that, but the Piedmont hazelnut has three lobes. And that is very, very important. In fact, the name of the Piedmont hazelnut is Nocciola Tonda, because it's round, Trilobata Gentile, actually. So Nocciola Gentile Tonda Trilobata is a very special type of hazelnut. And it grows in the Langhe in the province of Cuneo. And it is generally considered to be the best hazelnut in the world. Italy is not the biggest producer of hazelnuts. Turkey is. But with all due respect, most everybody agrees that the best hazelnuts in the world are these from Piedmont. And there's other types of hazelnut in Italy too. There's very good high quality hazelnuts, for example, in the region of Lazio, where Rome is. But in fact, the one that grows in Piedmont is remarkable. Why is it so good? Well, it has a very long shelf life because of its fat content. It has a very high level of monounsaturated fats. It is the dried fruit that has the best ratio of monounsaturated to polyunsaturated fats. The Nocciola Tonda Gentile Trilobata, this three-lobed Piedmont hazelnut, is also very easy to peel, which is important. It is remarkably easy also. It has a high yield when it's shelled, and it has really an excellent aroma and flavor. And it is really a unique product. Of course, it's used to make hazelnut spreads. In fact, it launched a brand new product when in 1806, Napoleon created the embargo against England as a mechanism to create difficulty, hardship for the English. It didn't work, but he tried. But one thing that did happen is that cocoa became not available anymore because it was being imported through the English traders. And so the pastry chefs of Turin and Piedmont didn't have cocoa to work with. So to try and lengthen the broth, if we can say, they started blending whatever cocoa they did have with hazelnut pastes. And that's how the flavor of Gianduja was created. And it is a chocolate and hazelnut flavor. So the hazelnuts in Piedmont are a way of life. Even many of these producers, they don't own just vineyards, they also own hazelnuts. The hazelnut tree is a very hardy tree and has the advantage of growing where maybe the vine would have difficulty, or the vine, the grapevine is a very hardy plant, but maybe would not give the greatest wines. And so hazelnuts grow very well there. And the hazelnuts are part of Piedmontese cuisine. You have hazelnut sauces. Rabbit is a very good dish with hazelnuts. It works very, very well. And it's something that really characterizes Piedmont and the Langhe, especially just as much as the grapevine does. Hazelnut trees are very much a part of the Langhe, very much a part of the wine estates of the area, because many of them produce hazelnuts. At the Enoteca, they have the hazelnuts of the Castello di Neve and of Podere Rabaglio and of Marco and Adriano, Adriano, Marco and Vittorio is an estate that is located in San Rocco Senodelvio. It's an excellent estate that makes a number of really, really great Barbarescos. I love those wines because they speak of San Rocco Senodelvio, although they own vineyards in other townships as well. Podere Rabaglio, very small little estate founded by three friends, a brother and a sister, Filippo and Daniela and their friend. They really make a lovely Barbaresco as well. And last but not least, Castello di Neve, a really class act in Italian wine, a very beautiful castle dating back to the 1700s. It's been the property of the Stupino family since 1964. And they own about 20 hectares of hazelnut trees. So a really big producer of hazelnuts. Of course, the Castello di Neve is famous because it owns the monopole of the Santo Stefano vineyard within the Albizani MGA. So toasted hazelnuts, a real typical product of the Langhe, very typical product of the many Barbaresco estates. So I really recommend that when you think of Piedmont, you don't think just in terms of truffles, but you think also in terms of the many other products, hazelnuts, honey, and the other products we talked about last time, like Cugna. And I really think that a visit to Barbaresco, we love wine, we love seeing people, we love meeting people, the wine estates are fantastic, but Piedmont really has one of the greatest cuisines of all of Italy. And one of the reasons it has a great cuisine is because of the high quality of its ingredients. So when you do go to the area, make sure you try some of the classic recipes and some of the classic foods of Piedmont that have the advantage of marrying very well with Barbaresco. So I love it. I can't wait to go. I haven't been back to Barbaresco now because of COVID for over a year, and I can't wait to go. And I really look forward to coming. I plan to go back in the summer if everything goes well. And I look forward to seeing all of you. Really, I really do. Grazie ragazze alla Enoteca Regionale. Thank you to the Enoteca Regionale for organizing this. Buone feste. That's right. Happy holidays, everybody. Gabriele, Federico, John, I see you there. Everybody else, happy, happy holidays to you and all your loved ones. May 2022 be better than 21 and maybe even better than 20. And let's just hope that we get out of this as soon as possible and go back to living completely normal lives, because that would be good. Grazie, ragazze. Grazie veramente.
Ciao, grazie. A presto.
Ciao, grazie.
Ciao a tutti. Viva il Barbaresco.
Ciao, ciao.
E viva la 2017, che è veramente vini molto, molto buoni. Thank you. And...